So yeah, this morning the title of my message is Don't Leave, and the passage of scripture that we're going to be studying out of is in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31, and we'll probably just focus really on more of a shorter portion of that passage of scripture. Mark chapter 10, starting reading in verse 17. And when he was, is everybody there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. It took me forever to get there, so I would imagine y'all made it there before me. Mark chapter 17. And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and mother. And he answered and said unto him, Master, all these have I observed from my youth. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, One thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor. And thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come, take up the cross, and follow me. And he was sad at that saying, and he went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And Jesus looked round about, and saith unto his disciples, How hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? And the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answereth again, and saith unto them, Children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they were astonished out of measure, saying among themselves, Who then can be saved? And Jesus, looking upon them, saith, With men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible. Then Peter began to say unto him, Lo, we have left all and have followed thee. And Jesus answered and said, Verily I say unto you, there is no man that hath left house or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake in the gospels, but he shall receive 100-fold now in this time houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions. With persecutions. And in the world to come, eternal life. But many that are first shall be last, and the last first. Amen. Lord, we thank you for your word. And so, you know, the Lord had put this message in my heart, really before we had the camp meeting. I thought it was interesting because Joseph's message, he at least alluded to this passage of scripture or in one of the gospels to this rich young ruler. Nevertheless, you know, the Lord had already put it in my heart. He had put some various things about this particular narrative story. And really and truly, I'm really going to focus more probably on verses 17 through 22 in the message that I preached this morning. But in order to really move forward with this message, we have to get a little bit of some background context. And one of the things that's going on here is that there's a period that takes place within the ministry of Jesus' time frame on earth. You know, we've been teaching for quite a while. My style is that I sometimes get very passionate. You know, I meant to ask Brother Larson, I hope it's okay that we still get excited and spit and sweat and all that, and that the anointing can still move because that's what happens. When I start talking about Jesus, I get excited. And sometimes I've even had one preacher that I went and preached for in Marksville, and I said, Well, how do you think it went, Pastor? And he said, You don't fit in anybody's mold. He was irritated with me. He said, You don't fit in anybody's mold. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm not really here to fit in a mold. I'm kind of wanting to break them, to be honest with you. He said, you teach like a Baptist and you preach like a Pentecost. And I'm like, Well, hallelujah. Let's stay true to some good doctrine. Let's stay true to some good instruction. And let's get excited about Jesus because he changed my life.
Amen.
Amen. And so I just want you to know that that's kind of my style. I like to teach, but I like to preach. Amen. And so in this teaching, I want you to understand that there's a period of time here, and it was kind of interesting because I was already thinking of this, and I've thought of it many times. And when I sat down to lunch with Brother Larson, we discussed this, and he calls it a binder period. And I texted him and he responded, but I don't know that I really got the answer I was looking for, because I'm thinking, what did you mean by the word binder specifically? Because I'm real analytical and I got to know exactly. What are you talking about? I do know some things, though. I know one thing in the oil field, a binder, you put it on two different sides, you pull it, and it pulls things tight to the middle. A three-ring binder, you got two different sides and you got rings and it pulls things towards the middle. The truth of the matter is that in the old covenant, as we go through this little slide I have right here, in the old covenant, it was built upon external observances. It was a religion of externality, if you will. But moving into the new covenant, it's all about what can take place on the inside. Hallelujah. Yeah. It's all about grace moving and operating on the inside of it. And in the middle, we're not quite in the new covenant, and we're leaving the old covenant. Amen. Jesus has come to reveal to us what the new has in store. Hallelujah. And so that's one of the things that I was talking about, that the Old Testament was about external performance, and that the New Testament is all about internal change. And so, whether it be a binder, whether it be bookends, the law, once again, was external. But in the incarnation, if you will, the revelation of Jesus, or the manifestation of Jesus, you got to understand that the prophets foretold he was coming, right? For thousands of years, they foretold he was coming. And then when he was a babe born in that manger, hallelujah, and the angels told of the glory, the truth is that day came, hallelujah. And what happened was that the presence of God dwelled on the inside of him. The presence of God dwelled on the inside of Jesus. And really, before that time, that was not really the case. Yes, there were some certain circumstances, some special occasions where the Holy Spirit would indwell the man, like Bezalel, the guy that was given the wherewithal or the wisdom to build the articles of the temple, or the tabernacle, if you will, to beat the mercy seat out of one piece of gold and to fashion the cherubim upon there, and even to do the work of the embroiderer, so for the veils and the curtains that were on the inside of the tabernacle. The Word of God says that the Holy Spirit was in him, and that the Holy Spirit gave him wisdom to be able to do that, but that was for a specific function. And also in the book of Ezekiel, we hear on multiple occasions where it says that the Holy Spirit entered Ezekiel the prophet, and it said, "Prophesy, son of man." And Ezekiel would prophesy what the Lord would have him to say to the people of Israel. And then you would read maybe a couple of chapters later, and it said, and the Holy Spirit would enter Ezekiel again, and he would say, "Prophesy, son of man." So the point that I'm trying to make is that in the old covenant, the Holy Spirit did not continuously indwell the believer's life, but yet instead the Holy Spirit was with the believers, and he was leading and guiding them. But there's a transition that's taking place in the new covenant where the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of man. I'm just trying to give you some context of where we are in our story, our narrative of this rich young ruler that comes and presents himself to Jesus. Amen. And so in the midst, and so that's where we are. We're in this middle period. I use this picture here, the wedding of Cana, because to me, this was a revelation. This was a monumental point in my own personal ministry. Many people that have come to the church or the Bible study, y'all are familiar with this concept because I use it oftentimes. I haven't really preached this particular message, but I oftentimes use various things like this as examples. And when I was studying the Gospel of John, we taught it, I don't know how many years ago in the Bible study, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, the Lord gave me a revelation of this. I was reading in a commentary about this miracle that took place at Cana. Can I just be honest with you that I've been a very carnal Christian before, and I'm not so certain that I don't still need the Lord to work in my heart, amen. As a matter of fact, I know that I do. But I was so carnal and so fleshly that for a period of time, I was looking at this water changing into wine almost as though, hey man, this allows me to drink a little wine on the side if that's what I want to do. You let the Holy Spirit deal with you on that. I'm not okay with that. I don't think that that's okay at all for us to, because let me tell you something, even if you would say, well, that's not my problem, preacher. I can drink alcohol if I want to. The Word of God says that drunkenness is a sin. Well, the problem is that as you drink your wine or you drink your alcohol in public, even if you're not getting drunk, you could be offending and letting another person who equates, really and truly, it's about culture too. We live in the midst of South Louisiana. And people that drink, they associate drinking with partying. And the people that party are of the world. Come on. Yes. And the people of the church are called to be separated ones. That's what the word church means. I've already written it on the board for you a million times. Ecclesia. Ek, preposition, means out. Ecclesia means called. Called out ones. The church is supposed to be a congregation of called out ones. Lord, help us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be separated ones, to be called out ones. Amen? Nevertheless, I was a carnal Christian. I looked at this miracle as an excuse to say, well, Jesus turned the water into wine, so I guess it's okay. For me, I'd do the same thing back way back before I knew Jesus. Hey, man, God made marijuana, so it must be cool to smoke stuff. Come on. I mean, I hate to admit it, but that's what people do. They still do it today. They still justify their actions. No. No, it's not okay because it changes the chemistry of your mind. It causes you to begin to trust. That's another thing. I don't know why I brought all this up, but maybe somebody needs to hear it. It also causes you to trust in something other than Jesus Christ and Him crucified in order to receive the grace that you need to be strengthened in the midst of your circumstances. Yeah. People are like, man, I'm stressed out, preacher. A little glass of wine after work, after I've been dealing with all them kids all day long. I'm not hurting anybody. Yeah, but you're looking to the glass of wine to be your solace. You're looking to the glass of wine to be your peace. You're looking to whatever it is that you're doing to take the edge off so that you can make it through this chaotic world. And no, He wants to be the object of your attention. Hallelujah. He wants you to put your eyes on Him and what He accomplished for you at the cross so that you can receive grace to be strengthened and empowered in order to live for Him today. Amen. As we look forward to an eternity. But in this passage of Scripture, this wedding at Cana, I believe that it gives you an illustration of what I'm trying to say. Old Testament external, New Testament internal, and now we're in this period. I was questioning. I was like, Lord, why in this miracle, your first miracle that you would perform, it's got to be more than what I'm thinking. My thinking's all messed up. I need some help here. I read in a commentary, and the commentator said this one thing, and all of a sudden, a revelation hit me. He said, Jesus performed a transformational miracle. And all of a sudden, my mind started getting flooded. Jesus performed a transformation miracle where the internal contents of the vessel were transformed and changed. That's the new covenant. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. See, in this story, what we have is that we had six water pots, the number of man, that were used for the ceremonial cleansing of the Jews. So the external old covenant would try to cleanse man externally, outwardly, and they would have all of these various observations of washings, and they would try to wash the outside of the vessel, try to wash the outside of the person, but nothing in the old covenant would ever change the internal nature on the inside. But what this miracle did was it took something that was an Old Testament law observance and it allowed a transformation miracle to take place on the inside. Hallelujah. And what Jesus has come to do when He died on the cross and He paid the sin debt was to allow that very thing to happen to humanity so that the Holy Spirit could come and live and tabernacle on the inside of you. Amen. And so that's where we are in the midst of this time frame. Now, I got to tell you that the prophets foretold it. If you want to turn with me to the book of Ezekiel, the prophets told us that this time was coming. That's one of the amazing things to me. God did not do this in the dark. I love that whenever Peter said in his letter, he said, we have not followed cunningly devised fables. In other words, we're not telling you about something that we just made up here. The Lord didn't do this in a back alley somewhere. He did this out in the open. God's about light. He's been telling it. He told us about it thousands of years before it ever showed up. Amen. Ezekiel 36, verse 25. If you ever need to borrow a Bible, we always got King James Bibles on that back table back there. It says right here in Ezekiel 36, verse 25, "Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you." That's talking about cleansing. I don't have time to get into all the teaching about this. Is something that bothered me. I'm like, well, it's supposed to be about the blood. Why is there water? If you go into the book of Hebrews, it's real clear that I think Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. He said this. He said that all things, almost all things, were cleansed and sanctified with blood. And so what would happen is that they would make a mixture with water. This is not in my notes, but let me just go ahead and say it. Another thing I was always curious about was the ashes of a red heifer. And one of the things that I never had seen before, whenever I had read it and studied it and preached it on multiple occasions here recently, when I went back and saw it, they would burn the red heifer whole. That means that the blood was burnt in the red heifer. That means the blood was contained within the ashes therein. That means that whenever the ashes of the red heifer were put into the water for purification purposes, that in a spiritual sense, the blood was in there. They never did burn the animal whenever they would offer it up on the altar with the blood in it. The blood was always drained beforehand. But in this one particular case, the blood was burnt with the red heifer, and therefore the blood was contained within the ashes. What I'm trying to tell you is that in Old Testament ceremonial cleansing, the blood was already in the water that was being used for purification, okay? And so really and truly, when you're talking about sprinkling with clean water, this is a foreshadowing of the new covenant whenever Jesus would bring the cleansing of the new covenant, which was him dying on the cross. He said, and so Ezekiel is an old covenant or Old Testament prophet, and he's foretelling of the day that would come. He says, "Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you will be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you." Just remember what I'm trying to tell you, that the Old Testament prophet is foretelling of the new covenant that will come one day. And then he goes on to say in verse 26, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you." See, the spirit of man is that part of man that when he's born of Adam is dead to the things of God. Whenever you are first born of Adam, your spirit man is dead to the things of God. We don't have time to break down the spirit, soul, and body right now. But what you need to understand is that you need your spirit alive to the things of God.
Amen.
First time you're born of Adam, you're born dead to God.
Yes.
But whenever you get born again, that's what this is really talking about. Hallelujah. When you get born again, your spirit man on the inside of you is awakened and comes to life to the very things of God. And so the word of God says that in that day, in that new covenant, when I sprinkle you with the water of Calvary, that you're going to get a new heart, and I'm going to give you a new spirit, and I'm going to put within you, and I'm going to take away your stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. See, that's the good news about the new covenant. God's doing something on the inside, and what he does is that he takes the heart and he makes it malleable. Makes it pliable. He wants to be able to mold it. He wants to be able to talk to you and to deal with you. Amen. On a personal level.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And he goes on to say this. He says in verse 27, "And I will put my spirit within you." If you ever read this passage of scripture before and you just read over that, you missed the whole thing right there. He said, "I will put my spirit on the inside of you." That's the whole new thing of the new covenant, that God's plan was to bring his spirit back to a place where he could live on the inside of man. Listen to me. When God created Adam and Eve and they had no sin in them, they enjoyed fellowship with the Lord. But when they sinned and they were expelled from the garden, there were cherubim with flaming, talking about judgment swords, that prevented their entrance back into the presence of the living God. Since that time, God has been methodically and progressively bringing his spirit back to mankind. And in the new covenant, he promises that for the believer that would only trust in his plan, that his Holy Spirit would now come to live on the inside. So, amen, hallelujah. That's one of the passages of scripture I wanted to show you. The other one is in Jeremiah, if you turn to the left a little bit. I'm just trying to make a point that we're transitioning from law to grace, from external to internal. Jeremiah 31:31. Says right here, Jeremiah 31:31. "Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt." What a beautiful picture of God's salvation story, amen, that his people By the way, if you ever hang out with us for any length of time, you need to be understand that what the Lord showed me anyway is that Israel is God's people just like Christian is God's people. And that big brother, he already went on a journey. And if we'll just look at what he did, we can learn some things, amen, from his journey that he went on. But the fact of the matter is that we both, the children of God, hallelujah. And so we can see in Israel our own lives and our own journeys. And what he said right here was is that it's not going to be the kind of covenant that I made with them in the past. He said, well, I took them out of the land of Egypt. You got to understand that when you were born of Adam, you were born under the bondage of Egyptian slavery, and you were born under the bondage of Pharaoh. Pharaoh is the enemy of your soul, and Egypt is the world, but hallelujah, God delivered you out with a mighty hand. Amen.
Amen.
And thank you, Jesus. And he goes on to say this, he says, to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they broke, although I was a husband to them, says the Lord. Verse 33. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. So in the new covenant, what God is saying is that, see, just as God took his finger and he wrote the law, which represented his character on those stone tablets, now in the new covenant, the very author of the law, the Holy Spirit, is going to dwell on the inside of your heart. He's going to write it on your heart, amen, and he's going to reveal himself. I mean, I'm talking about you can't get any closer than that. God's living in your heart, and he's speaking to you. I remember something that Brother Larson used to say whenever he said, thou shalt not kill, and he's like, now for the new covenant believers, it's almost like you should be slamming on the brakes. God, for God's sake, whatever you do, don't go that far. The Holy Spirit's already been dealing with your heart long before you ever picked up a gun and shot somebody if you were a believer. Long before you ever took somebody out and killed them. The Holy Spirit was dealing with your heart, and he was showing you that you had hate and that you had bitterness on the inside of you. And he was just asking you to come to him and to ask him to do a work on the inside of you, to minister to you and to change you. Whatever you do, don't go that far. Lord, help us. And so that's the difference between the old and the new covenant. Now, one of the things that you don't have to turn to these because I'm just going to kind of flip through them quick. But I wanted to make a point that in this transition from the old to the new, Jesus preached it. Jesus, you got to understand that Jesus, amen, he came, he was the light. That's what the Word of God says, that in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Amen? And through the Word, God created everything that's been created. Then in verse 14 of John chapter 1, we're told, and the Word became flesh and dwelled amongst us. Now, for the people that have been coming to the church, you can take a nap right now, but for the people that maybe haven't been, what you need to understand is that word dwelled means sanctuary. Jesus literally is the presence of God is sanctuarying, if you would allow me to say it such a thing, in the Lord. The presence of the Holy God showed up in Jesus, in his flesh, amen, in his physical person. The presence of God now has come in the midst of darkness and dwelled upon the land, amen. And so Jesus now in this binder period, in this interim between the old covenant and the new covenant, he is now going to proclaim the message of the kingdom. Nobody knows exactly what the message of the kingdom is all about. Yes, the prophets told us in Jeremiah. Yes, they told us in Ezekiel. And even the psalmist told us some things about the cross, and Isaiah told us. But Israel is so focused on their own life, their own nationality, their own circumstances. Does this sound familiar to anybody?
Yes, amen.
Christian is so focused on his own life, his own circumstances, his own things going on. Sometimes we miss. Sometimes we miss what God's trying to say. It happens, but God wants to get us through it. Jesus is trying to communicate to the people at the time this new covenant message. And one of the things he says is that the law and the prophets. Now, that was kind of like a Jewish idiom describing the fact that the entirety of the Old Testament was oftentimes referred to as the law and the prophets. Law being the first five books of the Bible, the prophets representing the minor and the major prophets. But it's just a short way to say that was the scriptures that they had at the time. Even in Jesus' time, the letters weren't written yet. Y'all know that, right? The letters weren't written until later, about 30 AD, starting 35 AD. And so whenever Jesus says this, he's talking about the scriptures, that the law and the prophets were until John, talking about John the Baptist. So when John the Baptist shows up on the scene, he begins preaching a message of repentance and a baptism of repentance to prepare the way for the way, to prepare the way of the Lord. And he says, since that time, the kingdom of God is preached and every man presseth into it. Don't be confused and think that that means that whenever you start telling everybody about Jesus, that they're automatically going to say, hey, I want to be part of that deal. No, that's not what it's talking about. It's saying that really and truly, they're still trying to come in according to their own way. He's preaching it to the religious folk. He's actually talking about the difference between law and the new covenant right here. And the fact of the matter is that mankind still tries to press his way in, still tries to force his way in, still trying to get in according to his own way and through his own actions. It doesn't work that way. The kingdom of God is being preached. And in the kingdom of God, this is one of the things that Jesus said in the new covenant. He said, come unto me, you that labor and are heavy laden. See, the whole system, and we're about to get into it a little bit, of the Old Testament and the Old Covenant was built upon works, and it was built upon self-performance. And they were working themselves to the bone. And the sad thing is that many Christians are taught a similar type doctrine.
Amen.
Come on, somebody, help me out. There's a difference between saying cross and preaching cross. The word cross doesn't mean that you're preaching. Let's just get this straight. Whenever we say the message of the cross, number one, we're not talking about a physical beam. We understand that. We're not talking even as much about a physical death, although that, without that, then you don't have the spiritual victory. But what we're really talking about is that the spiritual victory that happened in the heavenly realm when Jesus paid the price for sin and broke the back of sin, because it was a penalty that was placed upon man born of Adam, but the last Adam made right what the first Adam made wrong. He took his sinless life and gave it in our stead, amen, and allowed the penalty to be paid upon him. Thank you, Jesus. And whenever that happened, we were released from the bondage of sin.
Amen.
That's in a nutshell, the message of the cross. The old man born of Adam dies with Jesus, and a new man is resurrected to newness of life. Amen? And what I wanted to say is this, is that many people will preach their understanding of the cross, if you will, regarding salvation. Mankind is a sinner, and he needs a Savior. And they'll say, you got to put your faith in Jesus and what he did for you at the cross if you're ever going to have eternal life. But they're not preaching how you continue on in your walk with the Lord. You see, you can't go past the cross. The cross is the access point, we're going to get into it a little bit today, where you become righteous in the eyes of God. Because you're righteous in the eyes of God, now the Holy Spirit can live in you. Yes. Amen. And now that the Holy Spirit can live in you, he can empower you. And when the Holy Spirit shows up in the midst of your circumstances, hallelujah, come on, it don't matter. If you've ever seen it, you know what I'm talking about. He begins to transform, he begins to renew, he begins to change, hallelujah, things that you couldn't do on your own. All of a sudden, you see it happening in your life.
Amen.
Amen. But what most people preach, or have at least in the past, what I grew up under was, you give your heart to Jesus, but now you got some stuff you got to do. Now, one of the things that I realized that I've been preaching for a little while now, and I was so, because you know what? I was so offended when I realized that I had been believing in a works-based message. In order for me to get victory, I had to read more, pray more, fast more, go to church more, do all of these things, be involved in more ministry, and then now after I did all these things, God was going to show up and he was going to give me the victory. No, that's not how it works. But you have somebody grow up on that stuff, and you try to turn around and tell them, and I like the way that it's said like this, this concept, it was grievous to Abraham to tell Ishmael he had to go. It's a work of the flesh. Whenever somebody's Christianity has been built upon how much they do, and they're so proud of the fact that, well, I've read the whole Bible. Or I'm just telling you what was in my heart, and I've shared that with y'all before. I raised two hands. That person only raises one hand. I hate to say it. I hate to admit it, but that kind of stuff's been in my heart. Self-righteous pride.
Yeah.
Come on, somebody, help me out here. That stuff doesn't fly with the Lord.
Right.
God's not about that. God wants to reach in and he wants to do something. He says, I resist the proud, but I give grace to the humble. Humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, and in due time I may exalt thee. So the point that I'm trying to make is, and I know I've belabored this particular verse, the point is that you can't work your way through this journey. And many preachers are telling people that that's what they got to do. No. The same way you came in, Colossians 2:6. I don't think I'm not telling you to read your Bible. Come on, somebody. I don't think I'm not telling you to read your Bible. How are you going to know about this beautiful Jesus if you don't read your Bible?
Yeah, amen.
Yeah. How are you going to know about this beautiful plan if you don't read? Read the whole Bible, as a matter of fact, please. Start at Genesis and read the thing, amen?
Amen.
And not only do you need to read your Bible, you need to spend time in prayer. And you need to come to church. At least if for nothing else, get to preach to somebody to preach to. Amen? Hallelujah. It says, but what Jesus is saying is that in the new covenant, things are changing. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Yeah. See, Jesus wants to be the workhorse in this team. He wants to be the one that gives the victory. He wants our trust to be in him. Amen? He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. Has anybody ever felt like they were just struggling and striving in their Christianity? And it just wasn't getting accomplished. Jesus wants to give rest to your weary soul. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He also said this in Matthew. He told the scribes and the Pharisees this, the religious leaders of the day. He called them a bunch of hypocrites. He said, you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. For you may clean the outside of the cup. External religion. Trying to clean the outside. End of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. You blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, and the outside of them may be clean also. So Jesus, once again, this is, it may be veiled a little bit if we're not looking at it the right way, but once we start looking at it the right way, we see he's preaching the kingdom. He's preaching the new covenant. He's talking about, you're over here observing external observances, but what I've come to do is to do something on the inside. Amen. He goes on to say, this is just one of my favorite scriptures. I don't know that it goes exactly like, but with what I'm trying to say, but Jesus says, if I cast out devils, remember he cast out a devil and they accused him of casting out devils by the prince of devils, Beelzebub. And Jesus said, if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you. So the kingdom of God did come unto them in his presence. Jesus was there. Amen. Whenever we hear, once again, the Our Father, it should wake us up. And I know I said this the other day. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That tells us that things aren't really quite right still yet. Even though Jesus died on the cross and set us free, in a spiritual sense, we've entered into a new kingdom and we have access to grace. The fact of the matter is that things are not settled at this point in time. That's what the millennial reign is going to do. Jesus will visibly and physically come back and rule and reign. But he says, but if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come unto you. Or how else can one enter into a strong man's house? He's talking about the devil right there. See, the devil, whenever Adam fell to the way of the serpent, he relinquished his dominion to the enemy. God's sovereign and in control. You need to understand that. But at the same time, the enemy has power over those that are unbelievers.
Yes.
But whenever a man or woman gives their heart to the Lord, amen, it's a game, it changes everything. And what Jesus is trying to say is, how can you enter into a strong man's house? He's talking about this earth. Jesus called Satan the prince of this earth three different times. He's talking about this evil age. And he says, how can you spoil his goods? The fact of the matter is that the enemy has power over unredeemed humanity. But what Jesus is saying is that he said, first you got to bind the strong man. Jesus in the new covenant came to preach the truth of the new covenant. Then when he went to the cross, his death on the cross, and our faith in that gives us power to where the enemy in your life and in my life is bound, amen, to where he cannot move and operate just exactly like he wants to, amen?
Amen.
Yes.
And then this is the last thing, real quick, we'll read it. It says, and I will pray the Father, this is Jesus praying, and he will give you another comforter. Talking about the Holy Spirit. That he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you, and he will be in you. So you remember how I told you about Bezalel, and I told you about Ezekiel, and how the Holy Spirit would intermittently dwell inside of them in order for a specific function. Jesus is telling the disciples as old covenant or Jewish believers before his time. You know him because the Holy Spirit's been with you. He's been with our people. He was a cloud by day and a fire by night. He led and guided the children of Israel out of Egypt and was wanting to lead them to the promised land. He's been with us. He's been with you, but he's going to be in you. And what he was talking about is when I go to the cross and I pay the sin debt, the Holy Spirit now is going to come and live on the inside of you. And so now I'm back to my story. I set all that up just because now I'm going to real quickly, I just want to preach to you a little bit about this man that showed up. And so we're in Mark chapter 10. And the Word of God says that in Mark chapter 10, starting in verse 17, it says, when he was gone forth. Now we're talking about Jesus right now. It says that when he was gone forth into the way. And if you read on in Mark chapter 10, what you realize is that Jesus is on a journey of his own. He's actually headed towards Jerusalem. And as a matter of fact, later on in the chapter, he's going to explain to his disciples that when he gets to Jerusalem, that he's going to be bound and that he's going to be basically tortured and that he's going to be hung on a cross and he's going to be suffer many things. And the truth of the matter is that that's where he's going. He's on his road or his journey of self-denial. That's one of the beautiful things about our Lord. He lived a life of sacrifice. He lived a life of self-denial. And he paved the way for you and I to be able to see that. So when he was on the way, the Word of God says that one came running. I began to think about that. The Bible doesn't even really tell us his name. Later on in the story, we learn that he's rich. In some of the other Gospels, it's in three of the Gospels, every one of them but John, we learn that he's a rich young ruler. He's young, he's rich. He's a ruler. I read behind some commentators, maybe the idea is that he was a Pharisee. He's definitely not a Sadducee because he believes in the afterlife. And the Sadducees didn't believe in the afterlife. And so he could possibly be a Pharisee like the young apostle Paul was. But nevertheless, he's rich, he's powerful, he's a ruler. But yet he comes. He comes running. Well, once again, we're told his name. He comes running, and not only does he run, but he kneels. And kneeling, he shows a sign of reverence. Not only does he run and kneel, but he also asks. And he asks the Lord, what shall I do in order to inherit eternal life? So even though he has all of these things going for him in the physical, he still has a desire. He sees Jesus. The way that he approaches him, he says to him, good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? Now there's a lot that could be said about him calling him good master. The idea is that the rabbis didn't allow people to call him good. And he's approaching Jesus more as a teacher than recognizing his deity. Okay, so Jesus just goes along with that little line of thinking then. He said, that's where you want to live. But first, what I want you to know is that he's asking a couple of questions. First, he wants to know, what must I do? And once again, that's why I spent all that time talking about the difference between law and grace, talking about the difference between external observances and internal change. Amen? And one of the, what must I do is the question that he asks. Well, there's a lot of different passages of Scripture that talk about this concept of eternal life. And really and truly, if I read through all of this, I think I would probably kind of start losing some of you. So I'm going to be a little bit careful. But first, what I want to do is this. I want to say that, first off, you can't do anything, sir. You can't do anything to inherit eternal life. The Word of God says in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But that the truth of the matter is, well, let me go ahead and go to it, because I don't even think I'm quoting it right. So I'm going to turn to Romans chapter 6. It just didn't feel right. Romans chapter 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So God is offering a gift, and the gift is called eternal life. Amen? And so you can't do anything, sir, in order to earn eternal life. But one of the other things that I wanted you to see is that in the Romans 5:17 passage, it talks about another gift. It says in Romans 5:17, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, Much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. So eternal life is directly connected to righteousness. And righteousness isn't what you or I do, but instead righteousness is who he was. And his offering, once again, I know I say it a lot, and I'm going to keep on saying it, and I won't ever stop saying it. His offering of his righteousness and his sinless life allowed a transference to take place where your guilt was laid upon him, hallelujah, and his righteousness was placed upon you. And in that righteous standing, now the Holy Spirit was allowed to come and live on the inside of you. Now, I'm going to go ahead and just go through it. Galatians chapter 3, verse 5. Galatians 3, verse 5. Now, what I want you to see in this passage of Scripture is how the promise of God that was given to Abraham is so closely connected to righteousness and the Holy Spirit, and that we're equating all of this having to do with eternal life, because it's important that you understand these concepts. We want to learn the Bible. We want to understand, what does righteousness even mean? We want to understand, what are the promises? How do we have life? Amen? And it says in Galatians 3, verse 5, he therefore that ministered to you in the Spirit and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? See, what Paul was preaching to the Galatians is that what I told you earlier, that he came to them and he said, when I came to you, I preached Jesus, I'm paraphrasing, in such a way that it was as though you saw him publicly portrayed as crucified amongst you. In other words, I preached the cross so vividly that it was almost like we were watching a film on the screen. But now some other preachers have come in behind me, and they told you that you have to be circumcised, or that you got to add something else to your faith. Come on, somebody. You're going to add all kind of stuff to your faith if you're not careful. They got churches nowadays, they got programs in the midst of their church, and they say, oh, what you need for victory now is to work this program, and they add a little scripture to some psychology. No, sir, that doesn't work. That's now you've made an offense in the plan of God. Now you said that Jesus' sacrifice wasn't enough to pay the penalty, Amen. And that the Holy Ghost can't show up and fill you up and set you free. Amen. Now you're embracing another system, and it ain't the system of God. I'm just going to tell you that right now. Amen. And you can sit there and you can try to do your own works and your own performance. You can sit there and you can try to read all you want, like I've already said. You can try to go to church all you want. Nope. Now you're trying to say that the Lord didn't set you free when he died on the cross. Uh-huh. What did you say earlier? It is finished, is what Jesus said. Hallelujah. His work is done. Thank you, Lord. He makes new creations in Christ, all right? And so he goes on to say, but that's what they did. These preachers came in behind him and said, you got to add these other things. And so what Paul's asking is, he said, the Spirit that works miracles, still in verse 5, among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? In other words, you started off by believing in what Jesus did for you at the cross. Now you're going to be perfected through what you do. And so Paul's like, how do you think he works in your life anyway? See, we preached this a while back. There is a close, you cannot separate the connection between the moving and operation of the Holy Spirit in your life and the cross of Calvary. The two are interconnected. That's why the Lamb has seven eyes which represent the Spirit. They're connected to one another. And I'm talking about in the Revelation, the Lamb, amen? It's the Lamb who was slain. And he's got number seven is perfection and fulfillment, and it's descriptive of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit and the Lamb are working in tandem to move and operate in the lives of God's people. It says in verse 6, even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Faith. Amen? You see the connection between faith and righteousness. We're talking about eternal life, and we're talking about righteousness. Know ye therefore, because the gift of God is also righteousness, not just eternal life, and that the two are connected. And then it requires faith. Know you therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel in advance. So then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. If you put faith in Christ, then hallelujah, you have believed in the same faith that Abraham had. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse of the law. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continues not in all things that are written in the book of the law to do them. Now, I just want to make a point right here, because we're about to go back to our story. And this man wants to know, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And Jesus is about to make some suggestions for him. Jesus is about to make some suggestions. He's going to bring it back to the law. But what it says right here in this passage of Scripture is this, is that cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. You want to live according to the law, you better make sure that you can do it all. Because you can't fail in one spot and think that now you're righteous. Yes, the law represents the righteous character of God. But if you're going to try to accomplish it, you got to accomplish the whole thing. You can't fail in one spot.
Amen.
And when you fail in one spot, you're no longer righteous in the eyes of God.
Amen.
And the law was supposed to be for a purpose. Amen. To be our schoolmaster, our nanny, to carry us to the place where we would realize that we needed Jesus.
Amen.
It says right here, verse 11, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God, it is evident, for the just shall live by faith. The law is not of faith. But the man that doeth them shall live in them. If you're going to live according to the law, then you're going to have to do it. You're going to have to accomplish it. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Talking about the cross, amen. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Romans chapter 8, verses 9 and 11. I'm just trying to make some connections between eternal life, righteousness, faith, the promise that was given to Abraham, the plan of God, and the connection between all of them. Amen? It says in Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 11, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. So if you're a born-again child of God, that means that the Holy Ghost lives in your heart, and you're not in the flesh. You're supposed to be walking in the Spirit, amen? The Spirit lives in you. He goes on to say, verse 9, now if any man have not the Spirit of, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, then he is none of his. If the Spirit of Christ or the Holy Spirit does not live on the inside of you, then you're not a true believer.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And if you're a true believer and the Holy Spirit lives on the inside of you, then he's dealing with you, amen? He goes on to say in verse 10, and if Christ be in you, the body is dead, because guess what? We haven't received our glorified body yet. Sin will still kill this physical body. Should the Lord tarry and our body doesn't hold up till he comes back, this physical body is going to perish. But good news, there's a resurrection from the dead, amen, and we receive a glorified body. But so it says, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. You see the connection, the gift of righteousness. The faith in God's plan gives you righteousness. The result is that the Spirit of God, which is the life of God, now comes to live on the inside of you. Now that your spirit is alive and the Holy Spirit lives in you, you've now been given the gift of eternal life. There's a connection between the righteousness of Christ, the Spirit of God living inside of the heart of the man, and eternal life. And he goes on to say this in verse 11, but look, it's good for today too. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you. What does the word quicken mean? It means life. Amen? It's old King James for life. The same Spirit that raised Jesus up physically from the dead now lives on the inside of you. Hallelujah. And he can give life to your mortal bodies today. As you walk with God, as you talk with God, as you journey, come on, God wants to give you life.
Amen.
And the good news is that you're going to have eternal life because the Spirit of God lives on the inside of you. And so, back to our story, this man, he comes, he's one who comes running and he asks the question, what must I do? Well, you can't do anything, sir, but he wants to know about eternal life. And so Jesus turns around and he asks him, he said, this is what he says. Let's go back to Mark chapter 10. He tells him, you know the law. Keep the law. Mark chapter 10. He says, you know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Defraud not. And honor your father and mother. So, you want to come to me as good rabbi, good teacher? You want me to give you some wisdom? I'll give you some wisdom. See, this is the interesting thing. Jesus knows what's going on in this man's heart. Jesus, you know, look, he moves and operates by the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's moving through him. He's discerning everything. You can see whenever he's eating at the table with various Pharisees, he perceives what's already in their heart. He knows what's going on. He knows what's in there. And so Jesus poses this question and says, you know the commandments, go ahead and keep them. I put this up here because the fact of the matter is that this is just another example of law and grace. Just to try to break it down for you, the focus under law, it has all to do with works. And the object of what that I'm looking at is my own self-performance. I grade my own Christianity based upon how well I'm performing. That's law. You're operating, it doesn't have to be the Ten Commandments. You're operating under a system of law when you try to grade what it is you're doing based upon your own performance. But the result, when you look at that, when you look at yourself and what you're trying to accomplish, the result is always going to be failure. Yeah. Whereas under the economy of grace, when your focus is faith in what Jesus did at the cross, the result is going to result in victory. But what I want you to know is that he said, don't do these things right here. And so this is what the young man tells him. Verse 20. He said unto him, Master, all these things I have observed from my youth. I have this. How many times have you talked to people, and I hate to say it, but I know that I've done it too. I don't do this. You know, I don't smoke anymore. And so therefore, whenever I look at people that smoke, I shared this with y'all a long time ago, but I used to dip skull and I could hide that. You can hide it a little bit easier. You know? Just don't do it whenever you go around church, folks. Brush your teeth good. But what I'm trying to say is that I don't smoke. Well, good for you, but what do you do? Because there's something in your heart that ain't right. You haven't arrived yet. But yet, how easy is it for me to look at what other people got problems with and judge down on them? But the reality of it is that I just ain't got that problem, so I'm doing pretty good. That's called self-righteousness.
Amen.
I now make myself righteous in my own eyes based upon a comparison to someone else.
Yes.
Fact of the matter is that your problem might be more offensive in the nostrils of God than somebody smoking a cigarette. You know, and what I will say is this, well, how are you going to even say that smoking's a sin, preacher? Well, I'm going to tell you that anything that binds you up and has you in a place that you can't get free from, it ain't right.
Right.
Come on, somebody, help me out here.
Amen. Right.
The Lord didn't ask us to be, and if it destroys your body, it's not right.
Yeah.
And you don't need me to tell you that. Come on. If you got the Holy Ghost living in your heart, he's already showed you. That's why I threw about 10 rolls of skull in the Gulf of Mexico when I was a snubbing man, and immediately 2 days later would call my wife to mail some back to the office and they send it back out there. I'm trying to live by law. I'd swing that stuff as far as I could in the Gulf, but the next thing you know, I'm like, I gotta have more. But when the Lord will deliver you, you don't want it no more.
Amen.
I look at that stuff now and just think, oh, I don't want that. That stuff will destroy me. Anyway. He said right here, do not, you know, and so he says, I've observed all these things from my youth. That's not really what the law is supposed to do, by the way. You're not supposed to look at the law and come away feeling righteous. The law provides the knowledge of sin. It's like a mirror and it shows you yourself. It shows you where you are not accomplishing what God desires of you. And it's supposed to bring you to the Lord. I like what verse 21 says, though. Verse 21 says,
we're going to move past all that. All right.
Verse 21 says, then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. You know, that word behold means to fix the gaze upon, to look intently. And so Jesus is looking past all of this peripheral stuff that's going on, and he's looking straight, and I believe he's looking straight into this man's heart. And he sees it. He knows there's a past. It doesn't take a whole lot of intellect to realize, you know, I mean, I know Jesus a whole lot. I'm not trying to say Jesus didn't have intellect. What I'm trying to say is even us being led by the Holy Spirit, we know that people have a past because we've experienced a past, right? I can assure you, everybody in this place has a story. It's not all the same story, but it's a story. And the fact of the matter is that Jesus knows that this man's got a story and that there's something on the inside. So Jesus beholds him and he loves him. Now what's interesting to me is what's said next is that not only does he behold him and loves him, but he also said. Because you see, I've been accused a lot of times that you're just not supposed to say anything. Like in other words, if a leader's not preaching the true gospel, you're just not supposed to say anything. And I agree that there's probably been times that my attitude hasn't been right. And I know that the Lord needs to work on me. But don't tell me that true love doesn't tell people. Don't tell me that true love won't tell somebody, no, this isn't right, this is wrong, and if you continue down this path, it can bring destruction in your life.
Amen.
That's not true. You have to tell the truth.
Yes.
Yeah.
Amen. No matter what, at all costs, you must tell the truth. Amen. Even if you aren't doing everything right. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
You still got it. Doesn't make you a hypocrite is the person who's living their lives in such a way and they're judging down and whatever the case. The fact of the matter is that none of us got it all right in this place, but that doesn't mean that we shrink back from telling the truth.
Amen.
Jesus, beholding him, said unto him, he said, you got this one thing. You're just lacking this one thing, this one area. Because you see, the man, the first thing, and don't think that Jesus didn't plan it this way. He listed all those things knowing that this man was going to say, well, I've been observing that. Those are external observances. That's the law. I've been doing good in that. I don't commit adultery. Why would I have to steal? I give money to people. I employ people and I'm distributing money. So I'm not to steal from anybody. All these things I've already done for my youth. Well, you got this one little thing. And you see, the difference between the thing that he had and the things that Jesus listed was the thing that he had was something on the inside that you couldn't see. It's covetousness. He held on to that money. He loved that money so much. I'm gonna get ready to close, but I'm just going to want to bring it to this point like this. He had a love for that money so much that he could not even entertain the thought. Even though he came, even though he kneeled, even though he asked the question, when it was posed to him, this truth about this money, sell all that you have and give it to the poor. That was that one thing on the inside that his heart was gripped with, that he was unwilling to let go of, and he couldn't entertain the thought that he would have to let go of that if he was going to stay with Jesus.
Right.
I'm going to tell you right now, the Word of God says that he went away grieved. He said he was grieved because he had great possessions. And that word grieved in the original language, in the Greek language, can also be utilized to describe a cloudy, gloomy day. I'm going to promise you something. There's going to be times in your Christianity that you're going to find yourself in the midst of a cloudy, gloomy day.
Amen.
Fact of the matter is that you're not going to get everything exactly the way that you want it on this side of eternity. There's going to be things on this earth that you want, and yet you're not going to be able to have it the way that you desire to have it. And there's going to be times because of that that you're going to find yourself in the midst of a cloudy, gloomy day. I just want to tell you something. Don't do the next thing that he did. Please don't leave. Whatever you do, even if you find yourself in the midst of a cloudy, gloomy day, don't get up. Don't leave. Don't get up and walk away. Don't leave sad. No. Stay at the feet of Jesus. If you hold on to him, if you stay right there, I'm telling you right now, the Holy Spirit will do a work. It might not happen today. It might not happen tomorrow. But if you'll trust him, he'll do the work that he desires to do on the inside of your heart. Amen. And he wants to restore unto you.